Church, and welcome to the virtual Sunday service at CAP. Psalm 118 and verse 24 says, "This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." Whether we are on the mountaintop or in the valley this morning, let's make that decision to rejoice in the Lord, for this is His will in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's praise Him. Let's make His praise glorious this morning. Would you join me as we celebrate? Come on, church, put your hands together.
This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice.
Our responsive reading for this morning is taken from Psalm 98. And I'd like to invite you to stand with me if you are able. And let's read this psalm responsively. Sing a new song to the Lord, for he has done wonderful deeds. The Lord has announced his victory and has revealed his righteousness to every nation. The ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Sing your praise to the Lord with a harp and melodious song, with trumpets and the sound of the ram's horn. Let the sea and everything in it shout his praise. Let the earth and all living things join in. Let the hills sing out their songs of joy before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. You may now be seated. Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? Our loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning so thankful that you have taken care of us, so thankful that you remain watchful over us, so thankful that you are our God and we are your people, your children, sons and daughters of yours. And we thank you that even as we look all around us and see the magnificence of your creation, we are reminded that you are awesome God and that you are omnipotent God. Lord, we are reminded too that you know all things, that you are omniscient and that you are present everywhere, not only here in this place, but in every home of ones who know you all over the world. Lord, you are omnipresent. Your presence is pervasive across the earth. And we thank you for that knowledge. And we pray, Lord, that as we come to you, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-everywhere present, that you would look down upon us with favor, that as we reach out to you, as we invite you to come and be a part of our celebration, as we sing praises to you, as we invite you to lead us in our time of worship, in our time of giving, in our time spent around your word, that you would come with great power and with great authority, and that you would let your presence be so very powerful in our midst. And we pray, Lord, that even as we come to you, that we would be transformed by your presence, that your word would find good soil in us, Lord, to grow and to bloom and to bring forth fruit. We pray, Lord, that you would be with all who are tired and weary and worn, ones who are sick and ill in hospitals or at homes, ones who have lost loved ones. We pray that your grace will be sufficient in every situation. We pray for those who are trying hard to make the money that they have last till the end of the month. We pray that you would provide resources, and we are mindful of the fact, Lord, that for the widow, Lord, you gave oil that never ran out, Master, until she ran out of pots. And so we come with hands open to you and say, Lord, continue to take care of each one of us, and we will continue to give you glory and honor. Now, Lord, be exalted in our midst in the remainder of this service. We ask this in the most beautiful, precious name of your Son, who is our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise your name, Lord.
You deserve the glory and the honor as we lift our hands in worship, as we bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor as we lift our hands in worship, as we bless your holy name. For you are great, you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. For you are great.
As we bring to the Lord his tithes and our offerings, let's sing the song, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious fountain free to water. beyond the river, near the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its sins before me. Help my walk from day to day, with its shadows over me. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my righteous soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross I watch and wait, hoping, trusting ever, till I reach the golden strand just beyond the river.
Shall we lift our offerings to the Lord? Our loving, gracious, generous Heavenly Father, thank you for the ways in which you have taken care of us through this week and even these days. Thank you, Lord, that when we thought that there could be no provision coming our way, you have provided. That you have faithfully made sure, Lord, that you have looked after each one of us. And we want to raise this offering and our thanks to you and say, Abba, thank you so much for taking care of each one of us. And we ask and invite your blessing upon this offering and upon each one of us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, church, we're going to get into the Word of God, and if you have your Bibles with you, would you turn with me to the 25th chapter of Matthew, the 25th chapter of Matthew, and we're going to read the first 13 verses, Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 to 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, and five were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps, but the other five were wise enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight they were roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming, come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the five foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Later, when the other five bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or hour of my return." Shall we pray together? Lord Jesus, help us to understand these words that you spoke and through this parable. Holy Spirit, touch our hearts, our minds. Let these words come alive for us, that we may be able to know and understand and heed what it is that we need to hear and understand and heed today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we've been working our way through Matthew, and Jesus in this last couple of chapters actually has been talking about the time when he will return. And the question that has been uppermost on the disciples' hearts, and they have voiced it as well, has been, Lord, when is this time when you will come back? When are you returning? And Jesus says, four times, and this would be the fifth time in these two or three chapters, when he says, you will not know the time. And then he gives some indication of signs that will be around at that time. But then he says, but still these are not the times, the time when I will come. And he leaves that open. But he says that the kingdom of heaven for which you are waiting, you must be prepared for that time, when it will be ushered in. When I come again, you must be ready. And then he gives us this parable of the 10 virgins, as we've come to know of it maybe, or the 10 bridesmaids, the 5 wise and the 5 foolish. Let's just look at this passage and see what it says at a very, very kind of superficial look at it. We have 10 bridesmaids, and the Bible tells us that 5 of them are wise, 5 are foolish. Why are they wise? Because they took extra oil with them. They were prepared just in case they ran out of oil and they would need it. Foolish ones didn't prepare. They just came with their lamps. And these were the old lamps that you lighted. It was a piece of cloth really soaked in oil. And then when that oil went out, it just kind of all became dry and fell apart. So they would need that oil. The wise brought extra olive oil with them just in case this happened. So they're all waiting. They're all together, and we can see that all of them have the same expectation. They're waiting for the bridegroom to come. And they're all one group together. There's nothing that separates them right now in their expectation of the bridegroom coming and for them to join the bridegroom and go with him. Now, the bridegroom is delayed, we find, and they're tired and drowsy and they fall asleep. And then when they are sleeping, the call comes saying, the bridegroom is coming, the bridegroom is coming. And so they all get up, and the ones who are wise take their lamps because they're still lit and they're ready to follow the bridegroom because it's 12 o'clock in the night. And this was kind of the way they did it, that he would come in the night, and so their lamps would make a wonderful procession all the way down to the bride's home, and then he would pick up the bride, and then they would go where to the point where the marriage would be done and then consummated and all of that. At this point, though, the foolish ones realize that they don't have oil, their lamps are going out. And so they turn to the wise ones and say, please give us some oil. And they say, we can't do that. We won't have enough. You go and pick up more oil. And so these 5 go. And when they are, while they are gone, the bridegroom comes. He takes these 5 wise ones. They go in and they enter the place where they are to be. And then the door is shut. The door is shut. Now, the 5 foolish ones come with new oil that they have got from somewhere, and they knock on the door and say, please, please, let us in. Let us in. Lord, Lord, open the door for us. But look at what the answer is. Believe me, I don't know you. Believe me, I don't know you. And so Jesus says, so you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or hour of my return. Keep watch. because you don't know when I will come back. The need is for us to be prepared whenever He comes back. Not that we need to be constantly gazing to see, oh, when is Jesus coming back? Because we see from this passage that when they were tired, they went to sleep. It was not that they were expected to keep their eyes open and wait and wait. We carry on with what we are doing, but we live in such a way that we are ready when He comes back. And when He comes back, He comes as judge, isn't it? And that's what Jesus was saying. You don't know the time, but you've got to be prepared. You've got to be ready yourself for the time when I will come unexpectedly. All right. So that's the story, and the point here is that you don't know when Jesus is coming back, but there's a need for you to be prepared. And it looks like half the people were prepared and half weren't. And Jesus says, now you make sure that you are prepared when I come again. Now, let's just try and extrapolate a couple of points that may be worth focusing on. The first one, I think, is that they hadn't prepared themselves for the long haul. And I'm talking of the ones who are classified as foolish, the ones who didn't take oil. They hadn't prepared themselves for the long haul. They came with their torches. They thought this is sufficient. But the delay in the bridegroom coming proved their downfall. Secondly, they looked like they were all part of the same party, isn't it? They all came together. They must have been dressed together. They all had lamps. They all looked like they were where they needed to be and who they were supposed to be. They spoke like this together probably. They were accepted by them and they were all equipped. They all had a torch. And so it seemed like this entire party was one. They looked like they were one party. But there was one difference. And that was half of them came prepared for a longer wait than the others. So, what can we understand from these extrapolations? I think the first one would be that what the five wise had couldn't be transferred or given to the five foolish. Because they asked, they said, can you help us? And they said, no, we can't. So at that point, when the bridegroom comes, if you don't have what you need, it cannot be transferred to you by somebody else. That would be the first. And second, their lack of preparedness kept them out of the kingdom. Their lack of preparedness kept them out of the kingdom. Now that's sobering, isn't it? That if we were to begin to apply this to our lives and say, where Jesus is coming back, how do I live my life in expectation of His coming, even when I don't know? What are things that I need to be doing? Because if I'm not prepared for Him, then it could be that I am shut out. If I'm not prepared for His coming, then I can be left out of His kingdom. And that's what Jesus is saying in this scripture. So in other words, He's saying that some who thought they would make it won't make it. All of them thought that they would go along with the bridegroom, but they didn't. And second, and at that point, it will be too late. In other words, that it's possible that there could be some who are not thinking right, who are deluded, who think that they will make it, but will not. And when Jesus comes again and makes that delineation, at that point, it will be too late to make any change in preparing for that moment. I think Jesus himself alluded to this kind of a scenario many times. He said that it's possible that there are many people who can, for example, take the parable of the soils, that the word is given to some and it falls upon them and then it falls away. Or it has just a very shallow root. They don't take the time to deepen the root. And so it's gone. It's not able to withstand the storms of life. And some, when troubles and trials and adversity come, they just fall away. And so Jesus was saying that it's possible that some will not be able to withstand or stay the long haul. For a brief period, they will be there, connected in, but they will not last because the word hasn't gone and done what it needs to do in preparing us for the time when Jesus will return. The wheat and the tares talks about this as well, isn't it? Jesus said, the parable of the wheat and the tares, that they grow together and then finally they will be separated. The sheep and the goats as well. The sheep, well done. Come. For when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. All of these things come to one side and the goats to another side. Each of these places, isn't it, beloved, we see Jesus is delineating between people who just receive the word and fall away and ones who stay, who are prepared and are waiting for Jesus to come back and doing whatever they need to work out their salvation in the interim from being saved to being raised up with Jesus in glorification. In Matthew 22:11, you remember the wedding feast. The king calls the wedding for his son, sees his guest, finds a man without a wedding garment, unprepared, thrown out. Then in 2 Timothy 3:5, Paul talks about a form of godliness, but without power. In Luke 6:46, the Lord says, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? Whoever comes to me and hears my word and the things which I say, whosoever comes to me and hears my word and does them, I will show you to whom he is like." He's like a man who built a house and dug deep and laid the foundation. Matthew 7, "Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out demons, and in thy name done many wonderful things? Then will I profess to them, depart from me, I never knew you. Depart from me," he says, "you workers of iniquity." Then in the 13th chapter of Luke, Jesus says, "Strive to enter in at the narrow gate. When once the master of the house has risen up and has shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and knock at the door saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us,' and he shall answer and say to you, 'I know you not from where you are.' And then you shall begin to say, 'We've eaten and we've drunk in your presence, and you have taught in our and thou hast taught in our streets.' But he shall say, 'I tell you, I know you not from where you are. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity.' There'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth." So Jesus is saying that it is so important that while we wait for him to come back, that we prepare ourselves for his return. That there's a way that we need to live our lives in this interim time. So what would be our takeaway, beloved, when we look at this passage in Matthew chapter 25? Well, I think there are two takeaways for us. The first one is make sure that we don't fall into the category of the foolish five. Make sure that we don't fall into the category of the foolish five. How do we do that? Well, let me just give you some points that I think might be important for us. You know, being prepared is equal to keeping the light of the presence of God burning brightly within us. That's what it means to be prepared. That constantly the light of God within each of us burns brightly, that it never goes out. The light that we have is the light of God's presence. We must not allow it to go out. Without that light, we are not seen as His, and that light is not transferable to anybody else. So how do we keep that light burning? Well, let me give you four areas that I think are important for us to be aware and focused and working on so that our light shines brightly. The first is to make sure that we are growing in holiness. Make sure that we are growing in holiness. We've just finished Colossians, isn't it? What a wonderful time we've had in these weeks as we've mined it. But if you remember, I told you in the third chapter, what we need to understand are two crucial, important things that Paul is talking about. The first is that we put off, and the second is that we put on. And the path of holiness, beloved, is that constant putting off and putting on. Putting off and putting on. We put off those things that we used to be entangled with. Those things that he talks about in that list. Then we begin to put on those things that come from Jesus in our lives. We let those things begin to shine forth in us. So the first question that we need to ask ourselves is, am I growing in holiness? Each and every day, am I putting off and putting on? Putting off unrighteousness and putting on righteous behavior. Secondly, to ask the question, are we growing in love toward God and neighbor? Are we growing in love toward God and neighbor? You remember the rich ruler who came to him and said, what must I do to attain eternal life? And Jesus said, "What? You're a ruler in Israel. What do you think the word says?" And he said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength and mind, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said, go and do likewise. And he said, teacher, I've done all of these things from my youth. Then Jesus looked at him and said, go sell everything that you have. Give it to the poor and come and follow me. And he turned around and walked away because he had many possessions that he was not willing to give up. Beloved, to love God with your heart, soul, strength and mind is to love him in entirety. That you love him above everything. The rich young ruler thought he did, but he loved his money more. And the question for you and I today is, what is it that we love more? then we love the Lord. Or is there an area that we invest in more than we invest in our relationship with God or with our neighbor? So second point. Third, ask ourselves, are we serving God every day? Am I serving God? Am I using my spiritual gifts within the context of the church? Remember, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12, regarding spiritual gifts, beloved, I don't want you to be ignorant. Spiritual gifts, we see, are given to edify, exhort, and comfort the church. 1 Corinthians 14, 12. To build up, to encourage, and comfort. Are we, you and I, in the process of building up people, encouraging people, comforting people? Are we using all the gifts that God has given us in service to the church? Is the third question that we need to ask. And then fourthly, is our life a visible manifestation of the presence of God? Is our life, your life and mine, a visible manifestation of the presence of God? Jesus says, isn't it, in Matthew 5, 14, you are the light of the world. You and I, we are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. In other words, you need to be visible. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. Your light cannot be hidden. It must be visible. Instead, they set it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Each and every day, beloved, wherever you are, is the manifestation of God's presence visible through you. So, just those four areas, and there could be many more, but it would be a good spiritual reality check for us, isn't it? To say, I don't want to fall into that category of the five foolish bridesmaids. I want to be prepared. I don't know when Jesus will come back, but I'm going to do everything that I can to be prepared. I'm going to walk in holiness. I'm going to serve Him. I'm going to grow in love toward God and neighbor. And I'm going to let the manifest presence of God in my life be seen to everybody who is around me. Well, you may have been listening to all of this and say, you know, I'm not doing anything actively toward any of the things that you spoke about. And maybe today is the day for you to say, Lord, I'm sorry, I accepted your salvation, but I didn't allow you to bring change in my life. I didn't give rein and access to your Holy Spirit to lead me in paths of righteousness and service, in all of those things that I need to do to be prepared for your second coming. Lord, today I come to you and I ask, would you help me? I release the Holy Spirit within me to do what I need to do. Unstop my ears so I can hear what you're speaking to me. And Lord, here is my will. Make me, mold me, shape me in the way that I need to be so that I will be ready when you come. And I pray that you would pray that prayer if you fall into that first category. But the second could be that you're been doing it for a long time and you've grown weary, you've grown tired, maybe disillusioned. And maybe now you're just saying, Lord, how long are you going to wait? I'm ready for you to take me. How long, Lord? And you're just sitting by the side of the road and saying, I'm just going to wait for you. Beloved, I want to just give you two encouraging scriptures. Because right off the bat, I'll tell you that that place is not the place you need to be. It isn't. God wants you on the road following Him, and He will empower you. He will give you the strength, the energy, the wisdom, the stamina, the vision, everything that you need. You know why I know this? Because God is not in the habit of snuffing out dimly burning wicks. Long before Jesus came as Messiah, Isaiah prophesied about Him. And this is what he said, a bruised reed He will not break, and a dimly burning wick He will not extinguish. And maybe you're a bruised reed today, and maybe you're just a dimly burning wick. And maybe you need to go to Him and say, Lord, I need you to fan me back into flame. In and of myself, I don't have it. Lord, would you do it? And beloved, He will. He will. Paul tells us in Galatians 6:9, let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Don't give up, beloved. Don't give up. Just turn to the Lord and say exactly what's going on and how you're feeling. And say, Lord, would you help me? And beloved, He will. Shall we pray together? And I'd like to pray for both situations. And if you're responding to the first scenario where you're saying, I haven't done anything, but Lord, would you help me do that? I want to pray for you. And if you're responding to the second, that you're tired, fatigued, worn out, I want to pray for you too. But I'm going to pause now and allow you in this time, these quiet moments, to just respond to God. You speak to Him. You tell Him exactly what's going on and what the decision of your heart is. And at the end of it, I'm going to pray for you. Heavenly Father, on those who have decided, Lord, to get up and begin to allow you to work in them, to bring change and transform something they've never done before. Lord, I pray that there would be just a resurgence of your Holy Spirit within them. That as you take charge, Lord, that you would inspire, that you would give zeal and enthusiasm, Lord, to hold on to you and allow you to do all that you need to do to make them prepared for the time when you will return. Oh Master, anoint them afresh. Give to them fresh vision as well. Undergird them with your Holy Spirit. Give to them strength and energy, Lord, to pursue hard after those things that you have placed putting upon their heart, or even putting upon their heart right now. Then, Lord, I pray for those who are turning to you and saying, Lord, we're done. We're tired. We're worn. We're fatigued. We've been serving you for so long. Lord, we're ready, just like Paul, to be with you will be wonderful. Lord, how long should we tarry? Lord, would you come alongside of each of them? Hold them, Master. Let the beautiful presence of your Spirit envelop them. Let strength and energy pour into them. Lord, gently lift their heads so that they can see ahead. Lord, hold their hand that they can feel the strength of your hand. Lord, lift them up and point them in the direction that they need to go. And let them know, Master, that you will not leave them. You will not forsake them. Lord, let bruised reeds and dimly burning wicks, Lord, be fanned into flame, Master. Lord, if there are those who are hurting, wounded, Lord, would you bring healing upon them? Those who are just dimly burning, fan into flame. Restore, renew, invigorate, I pray, in the powerful, majestic, beautiful, incomparable name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Dearly beloved, our closing hymn is a hymn that just once again says, Lord, would you take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Would you stand as we sing this together?
Thank you.
Would you receive the benediction? Dearly beloved, and now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the continuing, enabling, inspiring presence of His Holy Spirit rest and abide with each one of us, beloved, until the very, very end of the age. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.